and opinions of the guests and hosts you hear on 1010 WOLB are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors or advertisers.
Shalom, shalom, Yisrael Ya'el, Yehonatan Dawit with you humbly on what they call the 26th of April, 2020. And to the Malachi. And to the
Malachi. Like
okay, and I will get off of the speaker. And to the Malachi of the Kawal of Philadelphia, write these things, says he who is Kodesh, he who is true, he who has the key of Dawid, he who opens and no one shuts, and who shuts and no one opens. I know your works, see? I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it, for you have a little strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Shaitan, who say they are Yehuda and are not, but lie. Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet, and to know that I have loved you, because you have kept my command to persevere. I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which will come upon the whole world and to test those who live on the earth. Look, I am coming quickly to hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the bayet of my Elohim, and will go out no more. I will write on him the name of my Elohim and the name of the city of my Elohim, the new Yerushalom, which comes down out of heaven from Elohim. And I will write on him my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what Ruach HaKodesh has to say to HaKahalim. And that's Philadelphia, Revelations 3, 7 to 13. And that's what we're going to talk about today. You see, there's each of these Kahalim has something unique that the Most High dictates to Yahkanan, specific to them. And it has specific rewards waiting for them. Now, Philadelphia is the one that everyone likes to claim, but none of you can. None of you can. Look at what Philadelphia is. Let's go to Revelations 14, 1 through 5. Now, people say Philadelphia means the city of brotherly love, and that it does not mean. It's similar, but the exact meaning of Philadelphia, if you go to the biblical Greek dictionary, you got to go to a biblical Greek dictionary, you'll see philos more exacting means a deliberately pursued synchronicity between persons. This is for an alignment or coexistence, a symbiosis. So you're really talking about really a unifying, a great connection between two persons. And then ah means unity. It does not mean city. It means unity. Delphius is womb. Ah. And see, this is the kicker. Because I told you Revelation is the improper name. It's Gola. Gola is a genetic word. These letters are sent from a genetic man to a genetic peoples, a specific group of peoples. That's what goal line means. And Philadelphia, Delphius means womb. That means that this, the actual meaning of this word is more telling. It is not city of brotherly love. It is a place of brotherly love between two peoples, male or female, that is intricate and together. They are synchronized and they are from the same womb. It is genetic. And that's what it is. Having said that, let's go to Revelation 14, 1 through 5. And we're going to talk, and there's some key words that the Malachim spoke that Yahweh Yeshua dictated to Yochanan, who these letters were taken by the Malachim and flown to these specific cities, to those assemblies. And they appeared into the assemblies and read those letters to them. That's deep. That has not been done anywhere else. So in 14, 1 to 5, it says, then I looked, and behold, a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having the Father's name written on their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, like the voice of many waters, and like the voice of loud thunder. And I heard the sound of harpists playing their harps. They sang as it were a new song before the throne, before the four living creatures and the elders. And no one could learn that song except the 144,000 who were redeemed from the earth. These are the ones who were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. These were redeemed from among men, being first fruits to Yahweh and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no deceit, for they are without fault before the throne of Yahweh. The Kahal of Philadelphia were given a great report card. All A pluses, no negatives. They are blameless and faultless. They didn't have to have any warnings like the rest of us did. Now, when you talk about these other groups that we talked about before, we know that they all are waxing and growing. This is this name of the Most High, this sacred name, is exploding and is being called a movement, a big movement. And I identified each faction and who they represented. So there is exploding, it's growing. But if you go back to Deuteronomy 32:15, way back, this is the book of Moses. He says, Jeshurun waxed fat, obese. Jeshurun is a prophetic name for Israel, a specific, unique name to Israel. Moshe said that they were going to wax fat, that they were going to get obese. Yahweh's people was going to be obese. That means growing enormously into obesity. Not in a good way. And that is what's happening now, is growing profusely. Now, but what did Yahweh Yeshua say? In Luke 18:8, he says, nevertheless, when the Son of Man returns, will he find faithfulness on the earth? Will he find faithfulness on the earth? See, that is a Hebraism. Many people do not understand the Bible because they don't understand the Hebrew fingerprint on it. Like when he told his mother, what do I have to do with you, woman? You know my time is not now. People saw that as being rude because they were understanding with an English mind. If he really meant rudeness to his mother, she wouldn't have then ran off and told the men, hey, good, listen, follow him, do whatever he says to do. She understood it the way it was meant. He did not mean what they have to do with you, woman. He says, I am here for you. You know, but realize my time is not yet. It's the opposite. It's the opposite. Remember, Hebrew is written from right to left, and even the thinking is from right to left. Our thinking is backwards. We take things the wrong way. When he says, I'll find any faith on the earth, that means he will not find faith on the earth. That's what he meant. So then how is Moshe saying that Yerushalayim in this time is going to be fat and obese? That means they will be, but there will not be truth in them. What will Yahushua find? Ezekiel 37:4 tells us what he will find when he returns. A valley of dry bones. Valley of dry bones. This in a time, and this is the last generation. We're going to talk about that when we get into the seals more detail. But this is the last generation. The World Health Organization predicts that there will be, by 2027, 10 billion people on the earth. Coincidentally, there's about the same amount of people that were on the earth at the time of Noah. At the time of Noah, about 10 billion souls on the earth. And remember, this is the last days. This is the last generation. There'll be, you're going to get the same thing as in the days of Noah. Yet, that Yahushua is going to return to see a valley of dry bones. But then when the Ruach goes into them, they will come up and arise and be an exceeding great army. 144,000 is the valley of dry bones. Philadelphia. Philadelphia. You know, of course, you know, preceding all of these broadcasts in these last month and a half, you know, we're operating remotely because of this COVID lockdown, which is displacing many people and is a direct attack specifically on the middle class and on Yahweh's people. But I'm not going to give those statistics, at least not anymore for the time being, because I have a lot of angst against these numbers that they're putting out. It's amazing how we can get thousands upon thousands upon thousands respirators delivered, respirators that must be put together by multiple countries and have thousands of parts, but we can't get a $2 can of Lysol. You cannot go out to the store and find a can of Lysol. Why? Because Lysol happens to destroy coronavirus. So what they did was, no longer can you get Lysol, and they changed the name to COVID, novel COVID-19, so you don't realize that you have something that you can get for $2 to destroy it. And it's a shame. It's a shame. You can get any kind of PPE you want, but you can't get Lysol. The visual we see on the news are people lined up for testing, people lining up for food, stores empty, but we're not seeing hospitals full. And I know firsthand, that they are not. So we see that all the field hospitals are empty. None of the field hospitals are being in use, and the step-down facilities are not being needed. Rain comes down every day. Overcast, I'm looking out my window right now, and overcast every day. Overcast every day, the same temperatures, around the same temperature, whether it's winter, spring, summer, or fall. Covering the dome, hiding what is really happening. Whenever there's a spike in so-called COVID deaths, follow where the rain went. So now we're finding that there's dangers, and everybody's their talking points are based on what they're told to talk about. No one's talking about these things that I'm talking about. Nobody's talking about the national debt, the weather. Nobody's talking about how fluoride has been in your water for, 100 years? That's killing us every day. Fluoride is killing us. And all your, across the whole nation, your reservoirs are underwater, so you cannot see what's going on. So I forge forward in talking about these so-called seven last churches, these seven types of churches. Next week is going to be the last week. It's going to be Laodicea. You'll see why I call it Laodicea, when most people call it Laodicea, but it's Laodicea. And we're going to probably have a special hour broadcast because we're going to usher in the Shavuot. So we may have to have a hour broadcast, a half an hour of Laodicea and half an hour of Shavuot. Today, to continue with Philadelphia. Philadelphia is a place of synchronicity, love between brothers from the womb. Remember, this world we in belongs to your elder brother, and it is going away. We are ushering in the next womb. That's why we held on to his heel. The ending of this world brings in the next world, which true Israel, those who love the Most High and his word, his Torah, are going to lead. What is their mark? 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 8. This is what the other assemblies lack, especially Ephesus. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of Malachim, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things. Believes all things. Hopes all things. Endures all things. Love never fails. Whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. Wow. Wow. What of our assemblies are full of prophecies? What of our assemblies are utilizing tongues and healings and miracles? And who is out there full of knowledge? Which of our assemblies are full of knowledge? All of these will vanish because they are doing it without love. It says that which is perfect has come. Who is perfect but Yahushua? This believers, the Philadelphians, are perfect because of their relationship. See, here's the thing that we are getting wrong. Many of us have great ministries. This right here is a ministry. My books and the One Plan, they're ministry. But ministry does not equal worship. Ministry does not equal relationship. Ministry, and it doesn't equal worship. See, ministry does not equal worship. Yahushua desires relationship. Relationship, intimacy. In your mikdosh. Your mikdosh is your private place. Your sanctified, set-apart place and relationship you have with Yahushua himself. You and him alone. We have corporate worship. We also should have private worship daily with him. It needs to be daily with him. This is a relationship. Relationship. Your works and your ministry, that gets you your crowns that you lay at his feet. But it does not get you into the kingdom. We have a lot of Hebrew Israelite groups that have works, but it's not going to get you in the kingdom. You're not be saved by it. If you don't have love, you ain't getting in. How can anybody don't have love get in when the whole redemption was based on the foundation of love? When the book says Yahushua is love. So how are you going to get in without him? He is love. He is the word, and the word is love. If you ain't doing that, you are sounding brass. You're wasting time. Your ministry is a waste. Your ministry ain't going to get you in. Your relationship with the Most High is what gets you in. That's what gets you in. And that is what goes in every day. Do not equate your work with worship. Do not equate your work with ministry. 1 Corinthians 3, 11 and 14. No other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Yahushua HaMashiach. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, what comes after that? Wood, hay, straw. Each one's works will become clear. For the day will declare, the day of Yah will declare your works, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's works of what sort it is. If anyone's works which he has built on it endures, he will receive reward. Now, here is what I want to show once again. How we are lost in the sauce for those coming out of Christianity. And even those who are Hebrew Israelite born all say that Yahushua was a carpenter. That is a lie. That is a Christian lie that Yahushua is a carpenter. And Jesus Christ may be a carpenter, but Yahushua is a brick mason. He's a brick mason. And the word for that is charash. 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 One can be a charash carpenter, but one can also be a charash brick mason and other whatever kind of highly skilled work of the hands. why would the narrative be that Yahushua is a Harash carpenter instead of a Harash brick mason? Well, here's the answer in 1 Corinthians 3, 11 through 14. We have here six different types of works built on Yahushua. Yahushua is a foundation. He is the foundation, and then we do our works. Our works don't get us saved, but they give us crowns. So there are six works listed by Shaul. Three of them, tested by the fire, only makes them better. It only reveals more purity in them. It only highlights them. They do not go away. And that is number one, gold. Number two, silver. Number three, precious stones. The other three will burn up. They will not be found. If you put fire you put a foundation of Yahushua down and put on top of it these other three items and burn them, they will disappear. You will come before him naked with nothing. Remember the parable of the talents given out and the one who was given one talent and was not fruitful in it and it was taken from him. He was cursed. He was cursed by Yahushua and put in his place. Because he came back to Yahushua with nothing. Do not come back to the Most High with nothing. And those last three items, number one, are wood, hay, and straw. So if your Messiah was a carpenter with woodworks, you have a Messiah that has nothing. Yahushua was a brick mason. And you know that. He tells you that he is going to prepare a place for you. He is building your temple now. He is building the kingdom. And he's not building with wood, hay, and straw. He's building with gold, silver, and precious stones with his own hands. He is doing it plumb and square, brick masonry work. And that city is coming down to receive the 144,000. Ah, Yahweh for Christians at gmail.com. Yahonatan Dao, we with you here. Listen and learn. Listen and learn. Yahushua HaMashiach, your brick mason, is coming down. It is coming to us, and the city, the bride made for him, is who he's making now. And that will not be destroyed. It's an eternal kingdom, an everlasting kingdom. So now we've been talking about Philadelphia. And let's go to Matthew 5, 6. And in Matthew 5, 6, he says, Yahushua says himself, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Philadelphians hunger and thirst for righteousness. They do not hunger and thirst for social media. They do not hunger and thirst to be right, to argue, to curse and put you down. They do not hunger and thirst to rise up by stepping up on your shoulders. They do not they do not have jealousies and envies. They seek to put anyone up, to help anyone up who's like-minded in Yahushua, who's like-minded. If they know something different than you, so be it, so what? If it's all for the same purpose, the same foundation, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness' sake. That's it. There's no competition. There's no battle. There's no I and me. There is a us, a we together. That's what we're going to talk about next week. Shavuot. The counting of the Omer is all about unity. Ain't about comparing and competing. It ain't about getting the most thumbs up, the most hearts, and the most likes. That's for your Ephesians and all the other churches. That's what that's for. But the Philadelphians hunger and thirst for righteousness, and they're going to be filled. Oh, yes, they will be filled. Revelations 21, 6. It is done. I am Aleph and Tau. He didn't say Alpha and Omega. That's Greek. The Most High will not. He would be better off eating a pork, greasy pork chop than saying Alpha and Omega. Because at least if you eat something that shouldn't eat, it's going to go out of the poop. It's going to exit you into the toilet. But what comes out of your mouth is in your heart. And that's a part of you. The Most High is not going to speak Greek. He's not going to speak Greek. The Aleph and Tau. The beginning and the end. I will give of the foundation of the water of life freely to him who thirsts. Yahushua, out of his side came Dam Wa Mayim, blood and water. So the blood signifies that he was one of us, and the water that he is not one of us, that he is the eternal one. And if you thirst for him, if you hung for him, take his flesh, take his blood, the water will, he will fill your mouth and you will no longer thirst. He will satisfy you like he did in the desert. In the desert, when you complained at the waters of Meriam, when you complained and complained to the lawgiver, you complain about being hungry and thirsty. He says that come to him, accept him, Yahushua. He is the fountain of water of life freely. He who frees you indeed and gives you life indeed. Not this life here, living your best life now. You can't live it now. You're being told to shut up, sit down, and hide in your rooms. The more you are involved in this world, the more inconvenienced you are right now. And guess what? All of these other six Kohalim are inconvenienced. None of them can worship the way they want to worship. None of them can have their ministries work the way they want them. They have different ways to get the monies to continue their ministries. Not the Philadelphians. Nothing changes with them from one day to the next. No matter what's going on in the world, they are one and one in their relationship with Yahweh Yeshua. Money does not have any impact on them. The rules and regulations of this government has no impact on them. They are not in social media. You do not see them. You do not know them. They are the Rechabites. That's right. It's tight, but it's right. And it ain't Hebrew or Israelite. It's Rechabite. The 144,000, those are the Philadelphian mindset mode of Rechabites. And you can look them up in the book, not Google them, look them up in the book. I've talked about them extensively in both of my books, especially the second one, about who these Rechabites are. One of the things about Hebrew Israelites, who all want to claim to be the tribe of Judah, by the way, ain't nobody come from Naphtali, ain't nobody come from Gad, nobody came from Dan, they all come from Yehuda. That's where they all come from. Not realizing that the lion that represents Yehuda is a pain and death to the ox. He's a pain to Yahweh. The ox is Yahweh. That's why in the desert, we made an idol of an ox. We didn't make an idol of a jackal. We didn't make an idol of a lamb. We didn't make an idol of a lion. We made an idol of an ox. Is the first letter of the pictographic Hebrew alphabet, which I taught you 3 years ago. Yahweh is represented by the ox. And in the wild, who attacks the ox but the lion? The favorite meal of the lion, the lion's favorite meal, if he can get anything else, will be the ox. The lion, which represents Yehuda, the ox, which represents Yahweh, is his favorite target, his favorite meal. You have always fought against the Messiah. You've always hated Yahweh. You've always been a thorn in his side. You've always been a pain in his ass. Yehuda. As such, yes, he did give you the promise, and Yahweh does not turn against his promises. You have the eternal Yah'ad. But his bride, his undefiled one, his pure, chaste, virgin one, are the Rechabites. It ain't you. Know that. It ain't you. It ain't Yehuda. Now, I'm not sorry to break your heart. Continue to stand fast, have an ear, and hear. Again, and this is the only Kohalim that was not admonished to well, they told to have an ear to continue their ways. So they're still individually responsible, but they have not got any lashes against the Most High. All was praise to continue what they're doing. To continue, all the Hebrew Israelites who want to name and claim and blab and grab and judge others are not the bride. Hopefully you're one of the five virgins who have your lamps trimmed and your oil ready, and you come in with him to join in the marriage feast as a witness and as a guest to sit on the outside and watch the marriage of Yahushua with his bride, the Rechabites. Hopefully you get in for that. Stay in your place. Be there at the table with your proper garment on so you don't get kicked out. The proper garment is the righteousness of Yahweh Yeshua. It's his righteousness. And when he raises that wine cup, Then you raise yours up and you eat and drink and sup with him. That's your lot. That's your place if you have an ear and hear. Do not think so highly of yourself that you're of the 144,000. Only those of that will not be tormented by what's going on in this world. And right now, we all are being tormented and persecuted. All of us, rich, poor, black, and white, by this COVID crisis. You know who you are by what's going on with you right now. Yehonathan Dawit with here, Yahweh for Christians at gmail.com, 443-306-3518. I know that was heavy. I know you didn't like that, but it's true. And the truth is always tight, but it's right. Ephesus, there were sound Hebrews with a lot of knowledge, but no love. They will be vetted out. Smyrna, to me, these are the Messianic Jews who like to use the name Yeshua, which is blasphemous. They will get a specific 10-day persecution. Pergamos, which is the apostolics. These who like to name and claim blab and grab and the practice Balaam in their religion. Thyatira, these are your black Hebrews thinking you're saved because you're black. You ain't saved because you're black. Black Hebrew Israelites are a loud sounding brass as well. And they have Jezebels from front to back on the pulpits and all over the place. They will be given, so foul are they, that their tribulation is going to be example to everyone else. That's right, it's in the book. We're going to talk about that. The tribulation placed upon Thyatira is going to be an example to everyone else. And those are your black Hebrew Israelites. Sardis, that's your Torah movement. They're almost like the opposite. Sardis is almost the opposite of Thyatira. Sardis is your Torah movement. Your Torah movement, they have a great reputation, and too many of us are following them, and they're the ones that have to use Yahuwah and Yaharalah, which your black Hebrew Israelites follow, because everyone likes to follow what the so-called white man says. A brother like me don't want hardly ever be listened to. They don't want to hardly listen to him. If another brother, a white brother, says the same thing I say, they will follow it. And that's what the Thyatira does. Sardis is your Torah movement with a great reputation, but dead works. They won't even acknowledge you. They will not acknowledge you and who you are in your history. As if the slavery movement didn't happen. As if this is not a land built on lies and blood and hate. A land of lies, blood, and hate. And Sardis, the Torah movement, are flourishing, but they're dead. So that brings us to Philadelphia, the only Kodesh and true and Sadiq group, the only one. So until next week, we're going to talk about Laodica and Shavuot. Yehonatan Dawit, if you're Yahweh for Christians at gmail.com. Shalom, shalom.